So hi everyone, my name is Aysh. I'm a volunteer with the IDI and I study political science at York University's Glendon campus. And today I'll be giving you a brief overview on the month of Ramadan and the practice of fasting. So fasting is a common experience in many belief systems. It's used for obviously spiritual systems, but health and dietary needs. And in general, fasting provides us with more control over our lives because the more we control our eating, the more we are in charge of ourselves. And Ramadan is the name of the ninth month of the lunar calendar. And the lunar calendar sets back 10 days each year. So this means that each year, we start Ramadan 10 days earlier. And as you can see in this graph that I have created also beautifully, last year we began fasting on June 18th, and this year we began fasting on June 6th, which was this Monday. So it moves approximately 10 days earlier each year, and thus Ramadan moves throughout the seasons. So an average person will fast in all of the seasons. And during Ramadan, we have two meal times throughout the day. The first is suhoor, which is at pre-dawn, before the sun rises. And during this meal, it's really about strategy because you want to get in a lot of carbohydrates and foods that will fill you up throughout the day before you start your fast. We drink lots of water, obviously. Try not to eat foods too salty, which will make us thirsty. And our second meal, iftar, which is the meal we're at right now, takes place at sunset. And fasting has numerous health benefits, but today I'm going to focus more on the spiritual aspect of fasting. So once we cut eating out of our lives, we can begin focusing on other things like our work and especially our spirituality. While we fast, we're not only cutting out eating or drinking, but we're also fasting with our senses. So we're trying to cut out bad habits and trying to gain new habits, new positive habits. And the reasons behind why we're fasting are just as important as the fasts themselves. So we're not only staying hungry, but we're trying to accomplish other things like spirituality and giving back to our communities during Ramadan. There are some spiritual experiences that we can only gain while we're in a state of hunger, and this is because we're sort of shedding the material needs that we have, like our need for food. So we can only gain some spiritual experiences while we are in a state of hunger. And keeping our intentions pure is thus very important because the reasons behind our fasts are just as important as the fast. And fasting is a very personal experience. It's between the individual and God. There's no social penalty for not fasting. And there's no social penalty for not fasting. And we don't even know what the reward is for fasting. But hopefully, we can all share it in the afterlife. And an individual alone is perceived as weak, but by fasting and by gaining spirituality, we gain the potential to become stronger emotionally and personally. And during Ramadan, we are required to donate a certain amount of money, and this donation is required during Ramadan while we are fasting because we experience a state of hunger, so we empathize more with those who are in a constant state of hunger. And donations during Ramadan in Canada have gone to hospitals, relief organizations, national and international relief organizations, to shelters and to various drives. So we sort of have the Christmas giving spirit where we focus not on how much we have, but on how much we can give. So these are some of the nuts and bolts of fasting, more of the technical questions. The first is, do children fast? Children do not have to fast and are generally advised not to fast, because especially during the summer, it's pretty hard. But the age with which one starts to fast is when they reach puberty. And usually children will look forward to fasting though and will fast a few days during Ramadan. It's sort of like a rite of passage for them. The second is, how do you cook for special guests while you're fasting? You can obviously taste the food that you're cooking just to make sure you know you have enough spices in there. What if you forget that you were fasting? So if you forget that you were fasting and accidentally take a sip of water or eat something, that's okay. Your forgetfulness was a gift to you from God. And this happens more to children. I haven't had this happen to me in a long time, unfortunately. How do you go to the dentist? You can drive there. you can take the bus. Obviously, if it's an emergency, you should definitely go. But if you can reschedule, that's advised. But I know for me, I wouldn't want to be going to the dentist while I'm fasting and hungry. It just doesn't bode well in my mind. But I wouldn't want to be going to the dentist while I'm not fasting anyways. And next question is, how do people in the North Pole fast? Because there's no night there. They just follow the nearest place which has a regular day and night routine. This goes for all places which have a complex day-night schedule. Last question is, I have asthma, can I use a walker? Yes, please. God doesn't want you to die while fasting. That's not the point. So these are some of the exceptions to fasting. The elderly, people with illness, and certain diabetics do not have to fast. Pregnant mothers, breastfeeders, menstruating women, and travelers also do not have to fast. So if the situation is permanent, like one mentioned in the first bullet point, then the person must pay to feed a poor person for each fast that they missed. So they're feeding a person for each day that they missed fasting. But if it's a temporary situation, such as traveling, then the person must make up for the fast that they missed later on in the year. And this is easier to do because, you know, missing a fast in the summer, you can make up for it in winter. And the last question is, I have a Muslim friend who is healthy. He or she is not fasting. Is this? Like I mentioned before, fasting is a very personal experience between the individual and God, and that's their choice, their very personal spiritual life. And in Canada, Ramadan is observed as a community, and this is similar to how the rest of the world observes Ramadan. There's a lot of focus on developing one's personal life, their spiritual life, and the community overall. And the IDI offers various fast-breaking experiences. And iftar doesn't have to be a huge event with at least 50 people. You know, it's just the name of the meal that takes place during the month of Ramadan. So for example, my favorite way to eat iftar would be at home on my own watching Netflix. Like, it's very simple. Overall, Ramadan is about setting goals and changing. Ramadan starts with the personal and individual experience of fasting, and throughout a month, because everyone has improved themselves and connected through hunger, the community is also improved by the end of Ramadan. So essentially, this month starts with the development of self, and it concludes with the development of the entire community. And in the end, we're all winners. And Eid is a three-day celebration which celebrates the new individual and the new community. It's similar to New Year's and the celebration of starting a clean slate in a new year, but it's more of a spiritual and giving celebration, so there's no fireworks, but being able to eat during daytime is enough of a celebration of its own, so there's really no need for fireworks. And to conclude, Ramadan is a spiritual journey we look forward to each year. It's both a physical and a spiritual detox. And during this month, it is advised to fix any broken relations. And we all enter a state of good and giving. So our ultimate goal is to have hopefully become or come close to being the best version of ourselves. So we will try to stay that way until next year and add a bit more each Ramadan. Thank you so much for listening and enjoy the rest of your week.